Many of you will have had the opportunity this morning to attend a scientific meeting, which I'm told was wonderful, and just the sort of thing that John would have wished to take place here, and that there were many tributes given by his scientific colleagues to him. But we, the less educated amongst us, also have an opportunity this afternoon to pay tribute to a great friend, not, I think, in the spirit of mourning, because John would not have wished that, but in the spirit of a celebration of a life that was quite extraordinary. In fact, having seen these photographs, I'm overcome by the number of kisses that John delivered in the course of his life to everybody, so far as I could see, and the hugging that he did constantly, and the feeling that he had to the family. And this was part of John. And it was amazing to see these remarkable photographs today. So we're here really to pay tribute and a celebration to this remarkable man, John Norris Bahcall, one of our century's most influential scientists, and I might add, one of the great influences at this institute, and certainly a great influence on me. I say that with a great assurance, because every time I did something that John didn't like, he was an influence on me. he exercised that influence in a number of different ways, sometimes on the phone, quite frequently just happening to be outside the room in a sweatshirt or something, quite frequently at a meal. But the one thing you were always sure of with John is what he thought. And the one thing that I was always certain of, that unless I acted the way that John wanted, he would continue to be there outside the rooms. I can tell you that I miss that. He was, as you all know, a professor at the School of Natural Sciences, president-elect of the American Physical Society, the recipient of the National Medal of Science, as we saw in the photographs, the Dan David Prize, and his greatest prize, I think, that he had in his life was his family. And I am very happy that Netta, Safi, Dan, and Orly are with us today. We're grateful to you for sharing some of John with us today. And I know very well from my conversations with him just how proud he was of the family, and if anyone was in any doubt, these photographs that we saw before really showed what sustained John and really helped him in everything that he did. I'm also very happy to welcome other members of John's family, John's brother Robert and his wife Sandy, their son David and his wife Paris, and John's cousin Ross, and we welcome you most sincerely to this gathering. I should tell you that John worked here under four directors. All of them were partially educated by him. The four directors were Carl Kayser, Murph Goldberger, Phil Griffiths, and Peter Goddard, and I'm very happy that Phil and Peter are here today. We all learned a great deal from John. He was a man, as I need hardly tell you, of tremendous intellect and great breadth. And when I was in the investment banking business, he told me how to run an investment bank. When I was running the World Bank, he told me how to run the World Bank. And I miss him now that he can't tell me how to solve the Middle East peace, because I'm quite sure that he would have had many lengthy conversations with me on that subject. And I think all of us recall from our own individual points of view the breadth of this remarkable man. He gave us lectures at the board. He gave us photographs, the early photograph of the Hubble Space Telescope I still have hanging in my study in Washington. Study, I might add, that my wife Elaine has taken over, so I don't see it very often. I've been put into a small closet while she enjoys that room. But she enjoys John's photograph, and he's there with us in our house. He was not only a great astrophysicist, but he was really deeply involved in all aspects of physics, and we're currently seeking to expand Bloomberg Hall into a center for systems biology, which I hope will meet John's expectations. One of our trustees was a little-known person called Michael Bloomberg, until John advised him to become mayor of New York. But now that he is mayor of New York, he's written a letter, and as you know, he was a close friend of all of us. And I'd like just to quote from a note from Mike, who respected John greatly. He said, "John was a vibrant and respected leader in the community, and he leaves behind him a legacy of scientific achievements and contributions that will inspire generations to come. His career as an educator spanned four decades, and the impact that he had on many students throughout this time is immeasurable. As a former member of the Board of Trustees at the Institute, I am proud that the Institute became a second home to John, and that throughout his tenure, his passion, intellect, and charisma guided us all. Throughout every pursuit, he always strived to inform and empower people, and to help bring about meaningful change in the way we think and speak about the world in which we live. John's life's work will continue at the Institute in the work of those he trained by his colleagues, and his memory will live on." Signed by Mike Bloomberg. Mike was greatly influenced also by John. I remember when I was trying to get Mike interested in the Institute, that one of the first people he met was, in fact, John McCall. And you may recall that letter. And so this was an influence that John had. But I cannot close without saying that the influence that he had on a generation of younger scientists who came here was perhaps the most remarkable and continuing thing that John had. I see Ed Witten, he probably had an influence on you too, Ed, and on others, as I see, and his colleagues will have a chance to speak. But quite apart from his professorial colleagues, it was John's interest in young people and in encouraging them and working with them, and as I know, keeping in touch with them over a span of years, that really characterized him not just as a great scientist, but as a great teacher, a great humanist, and someone whose memory will adorn this institution for many years to come.
John Bahcall, Richard Black Professor, was associated with the Institute for Advanced Study for 37 years, half the lifetime of the Institute. Throughout this time, astrophysics at the Institute was, of course, highly associated with, almost identified with John. John not only led a research group, he fashioned and sustained a way of doing research at the Institute, creating a way of leveraging the Institute's resources. His achievements in science were, of course, of the very highest order, but also his achievements as a leader and mentor of others have rarely been equaled in the history of science. An astrophysicist whose work interconnected with and motivated experiment, he formed a unique way of working in a theoretical institute. Although for most of his tenure he was the only astrophysicist on the faculty here, he created a group whose influence, both through the research it produced and through the stream of highly talented young postdoctoral fellows that emerged from it, was unparalleled. When the young Robert Oppenheimer first visited the Institute in 1934, he declined to stay because he found it full, he said, of isolated luminaries shining in separate desolation. 40 years later, John showed here that it was possible to more than shine at the Institute in quite the antithesis of isolation and desolation. No one was more connected in every sense. John produced here a new paradigm for how one can conduct research in an institute without a sizable group of permanent faculty and outside the context of a broad and comprehensive physics department. The key, of course, was John's relationship with Princeton University and the wider astrophysics community, a community increasingly populated over the years with the distinguished alumni of John's group itself. But of course, like many paradigms, whilst it gives us something to aim to aspire to, a path to follow, it does not provide an easy prescription, because the key ingredient to making it work is a person with a particular combination of talents that John possessed. And applied stringently, this criterion was only met by one person. John was unique. As Jim Wolfensohn just said, John worked with many directors of the Institute. When I first arrived here as director in January 2004, somehow I knew that one of the very first faculty members I should go to talk to was John Bahcall. John shared openly and generously with me his perspectives on the Institute and its development, and explained to me the opportunities and, of course, the limitations of the powers of the director. John saw that it was his duty to ensure that the resources needed for his work and for that of his colleagues were there as very soon as they were needed. Any loss of opportunity to advance scientific knowledge was a painful anathema to him. But John was also always there with genuinely helpful advice, the quiet telephone call pointing out behind the scenes that perhaps I'd admitted to do this or that. I'm sure that all of my predecessors also benefited from John's unique combination of scientific vision and attention to detail. My immediate predecessor, Phil Griffiths, who's here, sent me this note. He said, "It goes without saying that John was a great scientist, a great advocate for science, and an unusually effective implementer of science policy, as illustrated by his active involvement with the Hubble Space Telescope and in the Institute's own decadal review and numerous other initiatives. But what I remember most about him was his devotion to the Institute and its members. To John, the Institute was not so much a research institution as a postdoctoral university as originally Flexner envisioned. A superb mentor to his postdocs, John believed that the mission of the Institute was to provide the opportunity for visiting scholars to come and do their work, often transforming their scholarly careers in the process. John also shared my strong view that the Institute and the university have a unique and wonderful relationship that should be respected and nourished. He recognized that these two institutions, with their separate missions and administrative independence, nonetheless have common objectives and even a shared culture, and that each benefits immeasurably through its connection with the other. From my more limited experience, I endorse, of course, all that Phil says. John combined so many qualities. There was a unity, a unifying force in everything he did. His approach to his science was mirrored in his approach to leadership and administration, and indeed all aspects of his life. Really, there were no boundaries in his life. The science was not compartmentalized. He mastered and attended to the detail, but also always had the vision, the big picture, firmly in mind and evident to everyone else. For John, physics, astrophysics was fun, it was beautiful, it was deeply satisfying. And what he had been privileged to experience, he was very grateful for and not in the least complacent. His love of science went along with, indeed was inseparable from, his love of his family. Work-life balance didn't really seem to have a meaning because all melded together. The Institute will not be the same without John. He was indeed unique.
It's a great privilege to speak on this occasion, and in preparing what to say, I looked on the websites which John maintained and found a commencement address he'd given at Berkeley a few years ago. He told the students there two things: science was fun and science was unexpected. I think, as Jim Wolfson said, we should regard this as a celebration and not be too solemn today. And also, I think we realize how surprising and unexpected were the amazing outcomes of some of John's achievements. I first met John almost 40 years ago when I was a student and we were both attending a conference on quasars, which was held in all places, in of all places, the Fontainebleau Hotel in Miami Beach. It was my first visit to America ever, and I thought all America was like that. But I first really got to know John a few years after that when I came here to the Institute as one of his first postdocs. John was living in the project still. He was still learning Hebrew. Safi was a toddler. But it was a great privilege to work with John, and in particular to see how he worked. He was very systematic. He'd go into the office, write the dates at the top of a sheet of paper, and start calculating. I learned lessons from that, even though I never emulated that systematic style. But it was the start of a friendship and of repeated visits that I've made to this marvelous institute ever since. The most unexpected aspect of John's career was perhaps the single most important scientific theme of his work on solar neutrinos. Boris Kayser will talk in a bit more detail, but let me just give the outline of what this was about, because it was the most sustained and important of all John's achievements. Indeed, this 40-year saga is one of the most wonderful stories in the history of science. Persistence paid off handsomely and in a quite unexpected way. Neutrinos are perhaps the most elusive of nature's particles. They're a byproduct of nuclear reactions, and they're made in the center of the sun. But they've got no electric charge. They come straight through the sun and through the Earth, too. There are zillions of them going through our bodies all the time, but only one of them in our lifetime is going to actually stop in our bodies. So small is the chance that they interact with ordinary matter. But Ray Davis conceived of a most extraordinary experiment to detect these neutrinos. He built a tank containing 10,000 gallons of cleaning fluid, which is mainly made of chlorine atoms. He put it down a mine to reduce the background from cosmic rays and other confusing background sources. And John worked out that a few neutrinos per week would interact with the chlorine atom in this tank, turning that atom into argon. And amazingly, Davis had a technique to detect this argon. A few argon atoms mixed into a million trillion trillion carbon chlorine atoms. And here we see John going down the mine to observe this. Davis found evidence for neutrinos, but a third as many as John predicted. So had John miscalculated? Or was Davis overconfident in believing he had trawled all the argon out of his tank? This was a so-called solar neutrino problem. And Davis persisted heroically for 30 years. John updated his predictions whenever there was some improvement in the physics or astrophysics. But the factor of three discrepancy wouldn't go away. For more than 20 years, Davis was alone in detecting these neutrinos. But in the 1990s, other experiments came online. In Japan, Italy, and Russia, and then even more crucially in Canada. And they vindicated Bahcall and Davis. More important, they resolved the mystery. Some neutrinos made in the sun turned, while in flight, into a different kind of neutrino, which Davis couldn't detect. And this discovery is very important to particle physicists. The solar neutrino problem has become the solar neutrino opportunity. It's these underground detectors, not huge accelerators, that achieved the most important advance in experimental particle physics since the 1970s. And John never expected that it would turn out this way. And for 40 years, he was the unique guru of neutrinos, with an overview of all the theories and the experimental details. Well, in parallel with this, John worked on many topics in astronomy, and I mentioned just one of these. He was fascinated with quasars, these hyperluminous beacons shining at us from the edge of the universe. That's an artist's impression of one on the right. But just 40 years ago, with Ed Saarpeter. He wrote a paper pointing out that even if you couldn't understand the quasars, and we still don't understand them too well, you could use them to probe what's along the line of sight. And as symbolized here, if the light goes through clouds on the way from the quasar on the right to us on the left, then there'll be light absorbed from each of those clouds. And if the light is absorbed in a particular frequency, then in our spectrum, then you get different lines depending on the redshift of the different clouds. And John was involved in the first detections of this. He wrote a paper with colleagues at Caltech, where he very carefully, by an elaborate Monte Carlo calculation, showed that these lines were really due to intervening material. And here again, he was at the beginning of a subject which has really blossomed, because this shows a real spectrum of a quasar. Don't worry about the details, but on the bottom, there are lots and lots of lines there, and each of those represents a cloud or filament, a long line of sight between us and the quasar. So by studying data like this, we can do for the universe rather like geologists do when they look at geological strata or ice cores in the Antarctic, to probe back in the past. On that picture, as you go towards the right, you're looking back further in time. And so we can probe that there are different numbers of clouds turning into galaxies at different stages in cosmic history, all the way back now to when the universe was a tenth its present age. So that was another achievement of John, and he followed this up with a key project with the Hubble Space Telescope. I'd like to mention just one other scientific achievement of John, which I choose because it was his first collaboration with NETA on a scientific matter. Astronomers in about 1970 launched the first X-ray telescopes into a satellite orbit. And these satellites discovered objects where there was a small object thought to be a neutron star in orbit around an ordinary star. The neutron star gets very, very hot and emits flashes of X-rays, but it's in orbit around a fairly ordinary star. When one of the first of these was discovered, it was discovered that the neutron star seemed to be in orbit with about 1.5 day period. But the position wasn't very good, and it wasn't immediately clear what the optical object was. And it was John and Netta, using a small telescope in Israel, who discovered the optical emission from Hercules X1. They discovered it because, as you can imagine from this picture, the side of the star nearest to the X-ray source is being irradiated. It actually is about twice as hot as the other side. So as the neutron star orbited around, then you saw the ordinary star brighter when its hot face was facing you. And they discovered this. And I remember a seminar by John in Cambridge where this result was newly reported. It was a very exciting result at that time. Well, others will speak about John's organizational efforts, but let me just recall that to John should go much of the credit for the very existence of the Hubble Space Telescope and of the Baltimore Science Institute, which runs it at arm's length from NASA. And he remained a user of the telescope through his lifetime. And one of my last interactions with him is when I was on a committee he chaired to assess what should be done to keep the Hubble Space Telescope going after the recent shuttle disasters. And as regards his other services to the community, of which there were many, he, of course, was the chair of the famous Bahcall report in 1990, one of these decadal reviews where the American scientific community gets together to assess priorities. As a foreigner, I enormously admire the way the committee manages to coordinate the views of the American community of astronomers. It is educative for the astronomers, and it strengthens their case with Congress that they've settled priorities among themselves. And John, through his outstanding chairmanship, led a very successful and influential report of this kind. He was a marvelous chair, and he also was energetic in follow-through and in campaigning, as he was with the Hubble Space Telescope. But much of John's legacy, of course, is centered here, because he was an inspirational teacher and mentor who shaped the careers of generations of young scientists. And as has been said already by Jim, he made this institute a leading training ground in the country for postdoctoral researchers. And indeed, if one looks at the roster of those who've been here, it is extraordinary how many of those now leaders in the field had their initial impetus from a period spent as postdocs at this institute. Many of them are here today, and some will be sharing their thoughts with us this afternoon. John presided over the famous Tuesday lunches, an institution which is famous far beyond Princeton, where everyone sits around a big table and the latest ideas or theories are discussed. Any visitor is interrogated with Princetonian courtesy and intellectual rigor. And regular visitors like myself learnt that it was prudent to eat very quickly at the beginning of the meal before the interrogation started. But these institutions have led to a tremendous influence and have been imitated around the world. And it was for more than three decades that John led the astrophysics program here. One of John's last appointments as a postdoc here was one of my own students, Enrico Ramirez-Royes, who now holds a five-year position here. And I was very impressed by the way in which, when Enrico moved here from Cambridge, John showed just as much concern to him, both scientifically and over practical matters of relocation, as he'd shown to me more than 30 years previously. In an interview which John gave recently, he described an episode back in 1968 when he and Ray Davis reported their first neutrino result at a Caltech seminar. John was then an insecure young scientist. It's hard to believe it, but he was that once in the past. And he'd done a calculation, he'd made a much advertised prediction, and Davis had seemingly proved him wrong. So John was very depressed. And he recalled that Feynman, who'd attended that seminar, took him on a long walk and reassured him that he'd done a good job. That reassurance meant a lot to John, and I'm sure he himself consciously did the same to encourage younger people here on many occasions. Well, whenever I used to come here, the first thing I would do was go to John's office. He would ask, "What's new?" We'd start a scientific debate. Sadly, I can no longer do that, but John's monuments lie all around. In orbit above our heads, they lie in the astrophysics literature, in the particle physics literature. They lie in the generations of students who he mentored and inspired, especially here in Princeton. And above all, I think he set us all an example of how to be both an outstanding scientist and an outstanding human being. Thank you.
John Bahcall travels to great depths and incredible heights to investigate nature's mysteries. The hunt for the solar neutrino is essentially an answer to how does the sun shine? This search brought the young theoretical astrophysicist John Bahcall to the Black Hills of South Dakota and to Homestake. Homestake is a working gold mine, but to observational astronomer Ray Davis, it served as a 3-mile-deep neutrino detector. Here, Bahcall and Davis collected and counted the small particles in the large tank. Too few neutrinos were captured, though. Around the world, new detectors with larger tanks engage in the expedition, each seeking to learn from these subatomic particles how neutrinos dance and the sun shines.
We have main engine start. 3, 2, 1, solid motor ignition and liftoff.
I'd like to welcome you to the astronomical happening of the 20th century. What August 1969 in Woodstock was to the American rock community, April 1990 in Cape Kennedy will be to the scientific and astronomical community.
Bahcall and fellow Princetonian Lyman Spitzer led this fight for Hubble. Early disappointments aside, Bahcall persevered as its tireless advocate. With Hubble, Bahcall found the exotic objects of quasars residing in distant galaxies. Identified only in 1963 as star-like objects, quasars needed both the Hubble telescope and Bahcall to show us their beauty and their ever-still elusive nature.
It's like going into a cathedral. It doesn't matter how many times you've seen the paintings on the ceiling. It can be awesome, it can be inspirational. It can give you a very strong emotional feeling. When I look at space telescope pictures, every time I do and I see something extraordinary and new, it's like hearing a Beethoven quartet again.
The story of John Bahcall and the solar neutrinos is the story of a theoretical prediction and an experimental observation that disagreed. But both of them were right. The sun shines because of nuclear fusion reactions in its core. These reactions produce, as a byproduct, neutrinos, nu, which stream out of the sun in all directions, some of them headed our way. John Bahcall calculated the produced solar neutrino flux, the number of neutrinos that the sun produces every day. He also pushed, in collaboration with Ray Davis, for an experiment to detect these neutrinos from the sun here on Earth. The original goal of that experiment was to use the neutrinos to look deep inside the sun to test whether we correctly understand how the sun works. And John became the guiding and the encouraging spirit behind the whole solar neutrino effort worldwide. He and Ray Davis pushed in particular for an experiment using chlorine atoms to capture the solar neutrinos. And John calculated that chlorine would capture some 20 times more of the incoming neutrinos than had been thought before, making the chlorine experiment that much more promising. So Ray Davis and his colleagues mounted the chlorine experiment in the Homestake gold mine. The chlorine experiment found neutrinos from the sun, but it detected only a third as many neutrinos as John Bahcall had predicted the sun to be producing. That left several possibilities. John had to take into account nuclear theory, particle theory, solar theory. The sun is a complicated object. Maybe the theory was just wrong. Ray Davis's experiment had to do something that looked almost impossible. Maybe the experiment was wrong. Maybe both of them were wrong. But perhaps neither of them was wrong. To understand how neither of them could be wrong, we have to remember that neutrinos come in several varieties, or flavors as they're called, the electron, the muon, and the tau neutrino. Nuclear fusion in the sun makes only electron neutrinos, not the other kinds, nu mu or nu tau. And the chlorine experiment could detect only electron neutrinos. Consequently, John and others considered whether the missing neutrinos from the sun, that is, missing in chlorine, could simply have changed into these other flavors, which would have been invisible to the chlorine experiment. Whether that happens or not was definitively answered by the snow experiment that Art McDonald talked about this morning, his experiment. That experiment measures the flux of electron neutrinos coming from the sun, as the chlorine experiment does. But in addition, it measures separately the total flux of neutrinos coming from the sun, irrespective of their flavor, the sum of the electron, muon, and tau neutrinos. And what Snow finds is that the electron neutrino flux is only about a third of the total. Clearly, then, the flux of muon neutrinos or the flux of tau neutrinos or both is non-zero. Neutrinos do indeed change flavor. In fact, from this number of a third, we see that two-thirds of them change flavor between their birth and their detection here on Earth. So only a third of the neutrinos produced in the sun as electron neutrinos remain electron neutrinos all the way to the Earth. And since the chlorine experiment could only see the neutrinos that remained electron neutrinos, it should have seen only a third as many as John Bahcall predicted. It's rather the total flux, the sum of the fluxes and all the flavors, that should agree with what John predicted, and it does agree. The total flux is now measured by Snow, and in some units it's 5. And what John Bahcall predicts in the same units is 5. Yes, there are some errors, but you see, there is not a difference of a factor of 3 between these numbers. They are beautifully consistent. So John was right all along. In fact, John Bahcall and Ray Davis had both stuck to their scientific guns for something like 3 decades, and both were right all along. I think it's worth showing again, if I can get this to the right place, how John reacted to the good news from Snow that he was right all along. Nope, too far. Let me just show it this way, although it's a little bit jerky. I can fix that if I can get the audio on here. All right, never mind. What I wanted to show you has already been shown by Art McDonald. I had hoped to show it again, but never mind. The point is, John said that he felt like someone who had been convicted of a heinous crime, and after 30 years, a DNA test had been done, and it was shown that he was not guilty. He had gotten the prediction correct.
I was deliriously happy. It was, it was like, for 3 decades, people had been pointing at this guy and saying, this is the guy that wrongly calculated the flux of neutrinos from the sun. And suddenly, that wasn't so. And it was like a person who'd been sentenced for some heinous crime, and then a DNA test is made, and it's found that he isn't guilty. And that's exactly the way I felt.
What does this story illustrate? The initiative to create a new scientific approach to understanding how the sun works in a way completely different from what had been done before. Of course, the ability to cope with very difficult scientific challenges, both theoretical and experimental. The persistence to stick to one's guns, even when it appears that one might be wrong. And John's total scientific honesty That was what he calculated. That's what he predicts. If that's not what the experiment shows, then we have to understand what the discrepancy is actually trying to tell us. And what it was trying to tell us is that neutrinos change flavor, as we now know. And the fact that they change flavor has a very important implication. It implies that neutrinos have non-zero masses. The neutrinos weigh almost nothing, and for a long time there was no evidence at all that they have masses. But if they can change flavor, then they must have non-zero masses, essentially for reasons that were understood originally by another staff member of this institute whose name was Albert Einstein. The discovery of neutrino mass may have major implications for both elementary particle physics and astrophysics and cosmology. For example, it may be the key to understanding why there is matter, but not antimatter, in the universe. John Bahcall's wrong prediction, which of course was not wrong at all, and his persistent efforts to find out what the solar neutrinos are actually telling us, including a lot of very important work that he did on the possibility in the physics of neutrino flavor change, played a very big part in this discovery of neutrino mass. Like many people in science, I think of John Bahcall as a shining example of the very best that a life in science can be. He was passionate about science. He was very dedicated to it. He insisted on very high standards. And he had those qualities that were so nicely illustrated by the solar neutrino problem. John had a very big impact on science in a variety of ways, through research, through his mentoring, through his leadership. In addition to all of the other things that he did, he would have been the president of the American Physical Society next year. John was, and is, and will continue to be a very special inspiration. Thank you.
What was really extraordinary about John Bahcall was the many different levels at which he worked. Of course, there was his big passion of the solar neutrinos, which you just heard about from Boris Kayser and also from others earlier, where he ultimately was completely vindicated on all levels, both his model of the sun and his faith in the importance of the problem. And it really was an amazing achievement, given how complicated the sun was, to start from microscopic physics and end up calculating the temperature in the center of the sun and ultimately the neutrinos that come out so accurately. Then there were numerous other scientific problems that he worked on throughout his career. Again, we heard about a number of them this morning, like the quasar absorption lines and the structure of the Milky Way. But what really was special about John was that he brought the same passion to all the things he worked on, to the scientific problems, big and small, and also to his many projects in the larger world, where in the world of sort of making things happen in the world, he again devoted himself to numerous projects, large and small. Large ones like the Hubble, the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, the decadal surveys in astronomy, and what we'd have to think of as locally important but still mid-sized projects like running the science program at the Institute for Advanced Study. And even small ones like helping with the summer program for Italian high school students that Chiara runs. Whatever it was, John brought to it the same extremely high standards and the same passion. He was the one who got the most satisfaction from any nice piece of science done by any of the members of the IAS. He always had the best ideas about running our program here, and he approached it with the most energy. I probably should have worked harder at learning how he did it. John was always very interested in what everyone was doing. He was very interested in what I was doing, and often very helpful to me. And the only time he ever laughed at me was the time I asked him about playing tennis. John helped the rest of us stay young and irresponsible. And unfortunately, we now have to try to grow up a little bit.
Many things about John were special. I have time for only three of them. One thing that I remember vividly is the way he broke into Hebrew whenever he had the chance. As there are always plenty of Israeli visitors coming by the Institute, he had plenty of opportunities to practice his Hebrew. He made use of every opportunity, and I enjoyed listening to him chattering in Hebrew with people in the tea room or in the corridors of Bloomberg Hall. For him, it was a point of honor never to miss a chance to talk Hebrew. He had worked very hard to become fluent in Hebrew when he married Netta and got to know her family in Israel. He was determined to keep his fluency, and that meant practice, practice, practice. If you have not learned a language as a child, the only way to stay fluent is to practice it every day. I admired John's determination to keep talking Hebrew. I admired it all the more because I failed to follow his good example. I had the same reason to practice German as he had to practice Hebrew, having a German wife with a big family in Germany. We lived for a year in Germany, and I became moderately fluent, but after we returned to Princeton, I was lazy and let it slide. The lazier I became and the more my German retrogressed, the more I admired John. The second thing that I admired about John was his mastery of computers. The main difference between John and other astronomers was that John had a passion for accuracy. While most astronomers in those days, maybe now, were content to throw numbers around without much concern for limits of error, John was not. When John calculated a number, he liked to calculate it accurately, and most importantly, he liked to calculate the limits of error so that he knew how accurate the number was. So when he came to the Institute, he needed a computer to do accurate calculations. He also needed computers for the new generation of young astronomers that he intended to bring to the Institute and infect with his own passion for accuracy. He organized the purchase of computers for the School of Natural Sciences and the hiring of the technical staff that was needed to keep the computers and the Institute members happy. As a result of his efforts, the school now has a network of computers that can tackle everything from models of the sun to large-scale simulations of cosmic evolution. I admired John's energetic handling of computers for the same reason as I admired his energetic practicing of Hebrew. Once again, he was doing something that I had tried and failed to do. When I first came to the Institute, 20 years before John, the Institute computer project created by John von Neumann was leading the world in the design and use of computers and in climate modeling in particular. I was shocked and dismayed when the project was abandoned after von Neumann's death. I fought as best I could to keep the project alive, but I miserably failed. 20 years later, John succeeded where I had failed. Instead of looking back to the past, John pushed ahead into the future. The third thing that was special about John was that he organized the best birthday party I ever had. A big conference and banquet here at the Institute to celebrate my 60th birthday. He invited my friends and colleagues from all over the world, and an amazing number of them came. We had a grand time. If John had not been such a great scientist, he could have made a great career as an impresario. I've always been grateful to John for working so hard to give me a great party, and I'm sad now that I missed the chance to give a great party for him. And now we shall hear from John's friend and one-time colleague, Steven Weinberg, who is a professor at the University of Texas in Austin, and he regrets that he cannot be here with us in person. So we'll have the next best thing, Steven Weinberg talking on the video.
We all miss John Bahcall. Everyone admired him for his talent and his dedication. Through his own work and the work of the people that he brought to Princeton, he made the Institute what it had never been before, a leading center of research in astrophysics. But in just a few minutes, what I want to comment on is a different quality, his courage. Of course, it was Ray Davis and John Bahcall who set out to do the famous neutrino experiment measuring the flux of neutrinos from the sun. And of course, John was the one who calculated the flux that was theoretically expected. Then, when Davis's experimental results started coming in, it was clear there was a discrepancy. The rate of neutrinos coming from the sun was less than the amount that John had calculated on the basis of the standard model of the sun and the standard model of elementary particles. Of course, John continued his work refining his calculation, checking for errors. Now, it would have been the easiest and most natural thing in the world in that continued work for John to find just the right kind of correction that was needed to make the theory agree with the observations. I mean, my goodness, calculating the flux of neutrinos from the center of the sun, that takes a certain effrontery. And there were so many ways that he could have diddled the calculation, but he didn't. He calculated honestly what the standard model of the sun and the standard model of elementary particle physics tells you, and stuck to the conclusion that there is a discrepancy, that the number of neutrinos arriving at the Earth is less than that. And of course, now we know that that's right, that in fact there's something wrong, I shouldn't say wrong, there's something beyond the standard model. Some violation of lepton conservation at very high energies, which produces a mass of the neutrinos and the neutrino oscillations that accounts for the deficit of neutrinos from the sun. This was a tremendously important discovery. I would say it's the most important experimental discovery in elementary particle physics in the last quarter century. In a sense, it's the only new thing that experiment has told us in the last quarter century, the only really new thing, the only thing that is that can't be understood within the framework of the original standard model and that calls for something new at extremely high energies beyond the scope of the standard model. We wouldn't have made this discovery without those two people, Ray Davis and John Bahcall. They are the discoverers, in my view, of the neutrino mass and deserve equal credit for it. And in particular, without John's work, we would have Davis's number, a flux of neutrinos from the sun, and no one would know that it had any particular significance. No one would know that it was a sign of something weird happening when neutrinos come to us from the sun. No one would know that it was a watershed in elementary particle physics. Netta, we we all miss John, but he left behind him a shining reputation, and I would say also through his talent and his dedication, and I also add his courage, he left a brilliant example for theoretical physicists in the future.
The Department of Energy Fermi Award reads, for their innovative research in astrophysics leading to a revolution in understanding the properties of the elusive neutrino, the lightest known particle with mass. Dr. John Bahcall, would you please come forward for your award?
Secretary, thank you very much, Ray. My job is a lot easier because Ray has explained to you everything that you need to know about neutrinos. And the secretary has told all the jokes we need to hear tonight. How many of you feel after you heard Ray's talk that you have a personal relationship to neutrinos? That's great. So I want to tell you a story that will strengthen that relationship. Neutrinos, as Ray said, interact very weakly with matter. About every second, 10 billion of those neutrinos pass through your thumbnail, if you hold out your thumbnail. Every second, about 10 billion of those neutrinos from the sun pass through your thumbnail, and you don't even notice them. So they are very difficult to calculate, but Ray Davis and other experimentalists around the world went deep underground to do their work where only neutrinos could reach. Now, the basic idea of Ray's experiment and the other solar neutrino experiments was to use neutrinos, which interact so weakly with matter, to look deep inside the sun where the nuclear fusion reactions occur. And the idea is to do very much what your doctor does when she uses either x-rays or ultrasound to look inside your body and to make a diagnosis. I want to tell you an illustrative story about this particular field of research, a story that I think occurred in the early part of 1968. I'm not absolutely sure about when. Ray and I were visiting the Homestead gold mine where his experiment was taking place. And we were sitting on a rough bench putting on our miner's garb, that is, helmets, very thick goggles, long and heavy jeans that we had to wear. And the miners were very friendly while we were getting dressed. That's because of Ray's very special personality. Those of you who know him, he's very kind, very generous. He's treats everyone with exactly the same degree of respect, whether they're an apprentice miner or whether they're a distinguished professor. So on this occasion, one of the miners came over to our bench and he said, Oh, hello, Dr. Davis. How's it going? You don't look too happy. And Ray said, well, I don't know. He said, I'm only getting about a third the number of those particles that this young man, and I was young in... I'm only getting about a third of the particles that this young man said I should get. And the miner was very concerned. He obviously was distressed because everybody really loved Ray. And so the miner did what he thought he could. He patted Ray on the back and he said, never mind, Dr. Davis. It's been a very cloudy summer here in South Dakota. Now, in the end, as you heard from Ray Auerbach, Ray Davis got a few atoms out of his Olympic-sized swimming pool of chlorine every month. His number turned out to be right. My calculations of how many neutrinos are produced in the sun and how they are captured in his tank also turned out to be right. And we learned that, as Ray said, the laws of physics needed correcting. I have to tell you that even today, 40 years after the first such calculation was made, I find it absolutely amazing, this whole story. Thank you.
I never thought I'd have to follow John telling jokes. But I have a story to start out with. In 1970, my phone rang, and my office phone, I picked it up, and the voice at the other end said, this is John Bahcall. I didn't know John, but I knew who he was. And he said, I study galaxies and quasars, and I think a theorist ought to know how you gather data. So can I come observing with you the next time you go observing? So we made arrangements to meet at Lowell Observatory. And a few weeks later, Kent Ford and I gathered, and John was there. I hope you can see this. In the upper right corner, W.K. Ford, Kent VR, and Jay Bahcall. Not only did he come, but we observed two images, if you can read this. We were doing spectroscopy, NAB-16 and NAB-13. I don't know what they are, but Netta is smiling, and I have spectra for you. And I assume that NAB is Netta A. Bahcall. So maybe she can tell us what the objects were. I remember a few other things from that observing run that will sound familiar to you in view of the other things that have been said here already. It was great fun having John. He asked innumerable questions, some of them terribly incisive. We all had a lot of fun. It was very cold. He opened his bag to get his heavy winter boots, and what he found instead were thin galoshes. He was learning Hebrew. He had asked Netta to pack, and his Hebrew had slipped, and he got galoshes instead of boots. The other thing I remember is that by the second night, he and Kent Ford were napping on the cold dome floor. And I like it very much when my collaborators are napping, because then I have the telescope and can do the guiding and have what I think is great fun. But this was a request that no other theorist before or since has made, and that is to come observing and see how the data are gathered. I want to talk about John now. He was not only a great scientist, but he was an active citizen of science. He had a passion for being involved. For each activity that interested him, John became a participant and a leader. In the early days preceding the space telescope, he walked the halls of Congress, understanding that a space telescope would change the way we viewed the world, the way we viewed the universe. He served the American Astronomical Society as a counselor from 1978 to 1981 and president 1990 to 1992. John's term as president is still remembered for his activist role in informing Congress of the excitement and the needs of astronomy, a role that has not been equaled before or since by any other AAS officer. To refresh my memory of the early pre-days, the pre-launch days of the space telescope, I looked at a book that's been mentioned earlier this morning, I think, Scientific Research with the Space Telescope. These were the talks given at a meeting sponsored by the International Astronomical Union and held here in the Institute for Advanced Study in August 1979. This was before the space telescope became Hubble, which it did on launch. Not surprisingly, John was the only astronomer with two entries in that volume, one on the arrangements for the Space Telescope Institute and one on absorption lines in the spectrum of distant objects. This is an early example of his scientific life, a mix of science and public service. For the Astronomy 1990 Decadal Review, the decade of discovery in astronomy and astrophysics, John headed the committee of 15 astronomers and astrophysicists with its 15 advisory committees. Together, they digested the views of a wide cross-section of the astronomy community, reported their findings and recommendations. John put his heart and soul into implementing these and worked tirelessly for more than a decade to ensure that most of its recommendations were adopted. For the second time in his life, John lobbied Congress to make certain that the astronomical community obtained its first priority, this time a superb infrared telescope in space, which we now know as Spitzer. In 2003, John was elected vice president of the American Physical Society and was to advance to the presidency in the fall 2005. Unfortunately, his health forced him to resign in the spring of this year. In 2004, John was awarded the National Academy of Sciences Comstock Prize in Physics with a citation that read, "For his many contributions to astrophysics, especially his definitive work on solar models and his crucial role in identifying and resolving the solar neutrino problem." The AAS, the APS, and the NAS are only a few of the many organizations whose members will miss John's brilliance, his wisdom, and his enthusiasm for science. Over the years, the Rubin and Bahcall families have become close friends. Mathematician's son, Carl, worked for John as an undergraduate at Princeton. Younger brother Alan would be shipped off to Carl's Princeton dorm on the few occasions when Bob and Vera were both away from home for professional reasons. On these occasions, Netta and John would offer some oversight and some food. Alan must have liked it very much. He's now a geophysics professor at Princeton. And the Rubens reciprocated, offering rooms in D.C. and student tour guides for young Bahcalls while John was walking the halls of Congress. Although I wanted today to remind you of John's widespread activities on behalf of science through formal and informal channels, it is also his humanity that we remember. For many of us, our lives are different and better because we knew John. Thank you.
In 1982, I spent a sabbatical here at the Institute for Advanced Study. It was some of the most wonderful months my wife and I ever spent anywhere. The thing I remember best about that time was around coffee time, John coming out, yelling at the top of his voice, "Coffee!" summoning people out of their offices to time of warm camaraderie and informal discussions about science. Well, no one can replace John in that regard, so I wanted to bring and give to the Institute for Advanced Study a small gift in memory of John Bahcall. I don't know if it's ready, but it's a Chinese bell. You can ring it for coffee. Chinese bells have the property that they go a long way so people can hear them. But in addition, the Chinese word for bell, zhong, and the word for cultivation, zhong, sound very similar. So the Chinese associate the bell with autumn harvest and cultivation. I think in the cultivation of human talent, well, no one was better than John at that. We'll miss you, John.
John and I met in the fall of 1956. We were entering physics graduate students at the University of Chicago. We became friends very early in that year. John left Chicago after 1 year, but we remained friends until his death this last summer. During those student years, we didn't talk, and I don't think we thought very much about future success. I would not have been able to predict the kind of success that John achieved. There was a meeting here, a celebration of John's 60th birthday 10 years ago, and the after-dinner speaker was Bob May. Some of you may know him. Bob May was also an old friend of John's from Harvard, where John went on to do his PhD. And Bob May addressed himself to that same question. Could he have told at that time in some way that John would achieve the success that he in fact did? And his frank assessment was no, he couldn't tell. And not only did I agree with that, but as I recall, John agreed with that. And the reason is fairly obvious. That John was intellectually very impressive as a young man, but so were a lot of others. And it would have been a very difficult, I'd say rash, to make predictions on that basis alone. And so we didn't. But it is possible to ask a simpler question, and that is, what were the attributes that the mature John Bahcall possessed that contributed to his success? And could you see those attributes in the young John Bahcall? And there is one that I think a number of people have noted. Several people have mentioned that John thought physics was fun, and that's true. But I think deeper than that, John thought of physics as a deeply important human endeavor, and it was important with a capital I, and one was obligated to respect it, and he did. And that, I think, one could see in the young John Bahcall. I will spare you some anecdotes along those lines, but I think some of you have read a little bit about John's background. Know that he, before going into physics, he studied philosophy in college and then got diverted to physics. But by the time that I first knew him in graduate school, he had by no means lost interest in philosophy, especially the philosophy of science. And among those graduate students, even the best of them, he was the one who would step back from time to time from learning details of particular physics courses and try to make some kind of place of physics, some kind of assessment in a more general intellectual setting. And to the extent that I read anything about the philosophy of science at that time, it was at John's urging. But this is all in retrospect. I cannot say that I said to myself at that time, this is a serious guy who will go far. I didn't think that way at all. And it was only over a period of years, as I watched John's growth, his achievements, his leadership, and his growing prominence, that I looked on this with a sense of admiration and wonder, and also to some degree detachment, because primarily John and I were friends, personal friends, and that has never changed over the years. John left Chicago, as I said, and did his PhD at Harvard. We stayed in touch at that time, getting together whenever and wherever we could, in Cambridge, Mass, in Chicago, elsewhere. And likewise, when he was at Indiana, and especially during the years at Caltech, because I also spent a number of extended visits in California at that time. And then, after we were both married, we discovered that Netta and my wife, Ruth, were born on the same day of the same year. And this was a dandy excuse for getting together from time to time, which we did, just to spend a day together someplace, here in Princeton, Chicago, New York City, elsewhere. And it was fun. And we didn't think about those foursomes ending. I should say I didn't think about them ending. I think in John's last year, he may have thought about that. In fact, I thought I knew John pretty well. But the way in which he faced his mortality was something I was not prepared for. I had some inkling of this in a conversation that we had last winter, but it was said in such a low-key tone, just in the same conversational tone as the rest of the conversation, that I almost failed to pick it up. And some of you have read Netta's reports from the hospital about John's reaction to his own impending death. I find this among the more remarkable things about his life. When Netta told me on the phone that John had died, she broke down briefly, then composed herself and said, but you know, he had 70 very, very good years. And that was his own view and his own consolation. And I agreed completely with that, that if you could maintain that view, that was indeed the right view. And I miss John a lot, but taking a page from John's book, I realized that I had a great stroke of luck at the age of 21. I ran into John, we became close friends, and that close friendship endured without wavering for almost half a century. I feel very fortunate in that.
In early 1973, the Hubble Space Telescope was a very uncertain project and was viewed by most astronomers as something that was to benefit only their cloud-bound colleagues in the Northeast. The argument was that the not inconsiderable funds would be better spent on building a host of large ground-based telescopes. After my leaving Chicago and joining NASA as the chief scientist for the Hubble, I tried to broaden the support base and draw on a wider body of expertise by causing NASA to issue a call for proposals for scientists to be involved with defining what the observatory should be and how it should be used. This call was a typical NASA document, requiring that the respondents provide lots of information and fill in lots of boxes. Soon after this call was released, I received a short letter from a scientist that I knew only by reputation, who said he thought the Hubble would become a wonderful thing for astronomy and good luck with the project, period. I wrote back to John Bahcall, thanking him for his application. He made no reply. We then treated this short letter just like any ordinary application, selecting this theoretical astrophysicist and inviting him to become an observatory scientist. Fortunately for us, John replied yes to this offer, and the fate of the Hubble Space Telescope program was fundamentally altered. For John became one of a few persons about whom one can say, if they had not been involved, the Hubble would never have happened. The best known of his activities for the Hubble are those many phone calls and visits that John and Lyman Spitzer made while the Hubble's very existence was threatened with cancellation by the Congress. Applying Winston Churchill's words, these were their finest hour. Not so well known were John's contribution in working with NASA people and contractors in defining and refining just what the Hubble should be doing and how it could be done. The cultural gap between scientist-engineer and scientist-bureaucrat was often large. This was exacerbated by John's CPU operating faster than everyone else's in the room, so that sparks would often fly. Indeed, many of us who worked with him were on the receiving end of a fiery retort or rapid admonition at one time or the other. However, there was always a sense of strength of commitment to the project and to friendship that caused one to accept this. Things only once became so bad that he threatened to kill someone. The target was actually another scientist, but one who had turned bureaucrat. And judging by his book, that person has obviously not forgiven him. But that's okay, because John said simply what everyone else in the room thought. John stayed the course with the Hubble, being involved in management from 1973 through 1992. He stayed the course even in those dark days immediately following the launch, when it became obvious that the full image resolution would be available only for a carefully selected set of programs. He altered his science programs to use the flawed instrument and produce uncompromised science, some of the earliest with the observatory. He then continued to do excellent science with it for years. It was only appropriate that one of his last projects was to advocate that NASA change its now rescinded decision to prematurely terminate the observatory through failure to do another servicing mission. Happily, my working with John was not limited to the Hubble. John served as president of the American Astronomical Society in 1990 through 92, and I was treasurer during that period. As a fellow member of the executive committee of our professional society, we worked together often, and I saw how he effectively applied good judgment and leadership in a task that is best described as trying to herd cats. In addition to this leadership position, he did many other jobs, including the decadal study and chaired numerous additional less visible bodies. It is no exaggeration to say that John was the most important astronomer in the United States in the decades starting in the early 1990s, and he clearly deserved that reputation. The world seems a lonelier place now because of his early departure, and I too miss him.
Let's talk about one of the other landmarks in your career, and that is the Hubble Space Telescope. It was launched in 1990, and why did you get involved in making sure that telescope was launched, and how did it happen?
Well, I heard a talk about the possibility of this telescope being built by Bob Odell, who was a NASA employee at the time. What attracted me personally was the opportunity to participate in something that would affect the history of science. I thought I was going to do it for 3 years and not 30 years. I did it for 35 years.
But the telescope ran into trouble in its early years, didn't it, with President Nixon?
The administrator of NASA went to President Nixon in the early 70s and said, I want a new orbiting shuttle. And President Nixon had, from his office in management and budget, a limit on what he could give to NASA, and he said, can't accommodate this with all the other things you're doing. So in the discussion with President Nixon, the administrator of NASA agreed to take the space telescope out of the budget in exchange for a fourth orbiter. And it was not submitted in the president's budget, and it looked like it was going to be dead.
And so you got involved in trying to save it?
I got a phone call from somebody very high in the federal government saying, John, of course, it's illegal for me to talk to you now because the president's budget is embargoed. The telescope will be dead unless you and some of your colleagues want to do something about it.
So you had to testify on Capitol Hill?
Very frequently. I think what happened in this period, there was a I would say perhaps the most difficult decision I ever made in my life. And I made it together with Lyman Spitzer, who was the person who first proposed the large space telescope. I called, after I got this phone call, several other people to consult with them and discussed informally with my friends in the States the possibility that we might try what was at that time unprecedented, go to Congress directly as scientists and lobby to overturn the decision of the administrator and the president.
Wow. A radical movement.
It was yes. We were, we don't look like dangerous radicals. And I got a phone call from another person who is still living, so I will not mention this person's name. This person said to me, John, as you know, I've been a friend of the Large Space Telescope for many, many years and a prominent supporter of the telescope in the most important councils. But I have to tell you that if you and Lyman do what I hear from your friends you're considering doing, then that will be a disaster, not just for astronomy, but all of the sciences in NASA. The NASA administrator has let me know that he will take that as proof that scientists are not good team players, and not only will the telescope be cut out, but all other astrophysics will be cut out of the NASA budget. And he has said that he will make sure that it's known that you and Lyman are personally responsible for that.
Wow. Wow. How did you feel about it?
Well, I was scared to death, to tell you the truth.
Did you go ahead and continue your lobbying?
We did, with trepidation. And I have to say that Lyman reassured me on that. I think his statement was, it's worth it. The worst that they can do is make us look ridiculous and show that we've exercised bad judgment and have gotten our colleagues in trouble. And I'm willing to do it if you're willing to do it, because I think the payoff is worth it, and that was enough for me.
And so what happened to the threat?
By the end of that first summer, the space telescope was a darling on the Capitol Hill, and the threat never materialized, because the next year it was one of the primary proposals in NASA's budget. It was very popular because it answered questions that everybody wanted to hear about. And I think what made us willing to take the chance, Lyman and I, was the conviction that people like the people that are listening now, people that don't have a professional interest in astronomy, but just want to know how stars shine, how galaxies evolve, how old the universe is, how big it is, whether there are other things out there, what new mysteries we haven't yet uncovered, but we'll see when we have better eyes to look. That was a theme which we felt confident would resonate with anybody that we talked to that would give us a hearing, and by gosh, it did.
Let's talk about some of the main discoveries that the Hubble has come up with that most impress you.
I think the one that I'm most impressed with is the discovery of large black holes in the centers of essentially every galaxy where Hubble could get a good look. That's a very important clue as to how galaxies form and evolve. It was something that wasn't possible prior to Hubble. It was something that we knew that Hubble would have the acuity of vision to do, but we had no reason to believe that that was the case ahead of time. So that's one of the examples that I like.
I think that decision by John and Lyman was certainly one of the most courageous things that a modern scientist has done in a very long time. I will have a little bit more to say about John's courage in my remarks in a few minutes. I've been privileged to know John a very long time. I met him when I was a graduate student at Caltech, and he was a postdoc. And although we have never worked closely together, we have worked on very parallel things for a very long time. In particular, in the late 60s, when I guess this was the middle 60s actually, when I was just finishing and did my work with Bruce Peterson on the absorption by hydrogen in interstellar space in the ultraviolet in quasars, and John and Ed Salpeter were working on the same sort of thing. And then later, when I came back to Caltech in the 70s, and was working in a quite parallel way with John on the question of whether quasars were really far away, in which not everyone believed that they were really far away, were at cosmological distances, but most people believed they were at cosmological distances. And there was a very vociferous minority which claimed otherwise. And John and I were both working on this subject observationally. It was one of the first observational projects that John undertook. And I was actually quite amazed and gratified. I knew that John was an extremely intelligent human being, but his adaptability amazed me, because he became involved in, as Vera said — I hadn't heard that story, Vera, it's a very nice story — became very quickly involved, not only became involved in the observations, but became involved very critically in the observations, in which he could very easily separate the wheat from the chaff in observational data and knew what could be believed and what couldn't. The result of this kind of parallel development, but not working closely together, gave us many, many opportunities to have quite vociferous, not antagonistic, but quite vociferous arguments at various times. I lost most of them. The only one I really remember winning with much relish was an argument which, since I'm giving the talk, I can state the problem from my perspective. The problem, as I saw it, was basically the question of whether it was matter or statistical significance that generated gravity. And it had to do with the distribution of matter around our galaxy in the local group, and John's staunch claim that the fact that Andromeda was there basically was not statistically significant because it was only one object. John was a very gracious loser of arguments, however, because as soon as he realized that but what he was saying was actually quite foolish, and he almost never said anything foolish. He apologized profusely. My main interaction with John, however, came over the subject that has been touched upon here many, many times and that Bob O'Dell has just talked about, and that was space telescope. And another illustration of John's not only scientific courage, but sort of sociological courage. When space telescope was first put together, when the project was put together, there were quite a number of instruments on it which were so-called facility instruments, that is, instruments which NASA basically had laid the specifications for, teams had been assigned for these instruments. One of those instruments was the camera. And of course, the thing that probably all of us scientists and non-scientists in this audience know most about Hubble are the spectacular pictures that have come down, and of course the science that comes from those pictures. It was planned at the time that the camera should be a device called an SEC Viticon, which was being developed jointly by industry and by a group at Princeton led by Lyman Spitzer. And it was quite clear by the time that serious work on these instruments was to begin that the SEC Viticon was a very flawed device. It was not clear that it could be built. It was not clear that it would work very well if it was built, not certainly that it would work up to expectations. And John realized this very early and pushed, in the face of the fact that Lyman was here and his group was here in Princeton, that perhaps NASA should rethink this and open a competition for the camera for a general announcement of opportunity. He was at least partially influenced in this by a coworker of mine. I was at Caltech at the time, Jim Westfall, who had been working very hard on the application of CCDs to astronomy, a device which has really revolutionized imaging and spectroscopy in ground-based astronomy. And John persuaded NASA to do this, and Jim Westfall and I at Caltech won this opportunity, made the wide field camera, and the rest is history. And I'm sure that was not an easy thing for John to do. It was clearly, I think at the time, one can say in retrospect that scientifically it was the thing to do to open it up, not necessarily that CCD should have done it. We, of course, appreciated it enormously. When I first knew John as a postdoc, he was a very outspoken individual, let us say. Scientifically extremely rigorous, scientifically extremely honest, but with very sharp edges. We were very, very happy in the late 60s, I guess it was, Netta, that John was actually going to Israel and to marry Netta, because we figured that this would have some slight softening influence on John, which I think it in fact turned out to do over the years. So Netta, we are grateful to you for many things, but civilizing your husband is one of them. When I came back to Princeton in 1980, and I've been here since then, working closely with the people at the Institute, I want to say just a few words. This has been mentioned many, many times, about the really remarkable group that John put together at the Institute, group of young people. Its unique nature has been mentioned by many, many people. The fact that John was a lone faculty member putting together this really fantastic research group of young people, not only in solar neutrino physics, astrophysics, but over a very, very broad area. And John's breadth, of course, was one of the things that led to the success of this, his enormous attention to detail, his by this time enormous humanity, all led to the great success of this group. He really cared about these young people, and it showed in the results. And I think that there has not been a phenomenon like this in astronomy anywhere in the world. It's something of which John, I hope, is immensely proud. He should be. I was privileged to spend last semester as a sabbatical here, and of course I knew the Institute for a long time, but I had not actually been immersed in it before, was enormously impressed with the care that they gave to everyone, not only young people who needed the care, but old codgers like me who probably also needed the care for other reasons. But it was a time that I will remember tremendously. On one little other note about John's adventurousness, we've heard that before about the solar neutrino business, certainly about in the movie we just saw, in which it required an extremely adventurous soul to go and try to rescue the space telescope. And in an area that is also very dear to my heart, in the very late 90s, I had come up with an idea for a survey, a CCD survey of the northern sky. And John recognized that this was likely to be a very important thing in astronomy. He supported it from the beginning, which I think illustrated his faith in me, which I was extremely grateful for. But also, he got the Institute involved in it. And the Institute, as someone mentioned before, I don't remember who, that the Institute was a prime mover in making the Solar and Digital Sky Survey a reality. With the funding, he helped with persuading other people that it was a worthwhile thing to do. But it was also a great departure for the Institute, because I think it's correct. I don't know the Institute's history in great detail. But there was, of course, a period in which John von Neumann was here developing computers, the tools that we use every day today. But since then, the Institute has basically kept hands off all experimental things. And this venture of the Institute being a partner in the Sloan Sky Survey and pushing it so very hard was also something an adventure for the Institute and for John. So this is certainly a celebration of a great life of a great scientist, and we will all miss him terribly in the future. Thank you.
It's a rather humbling experience to follow such an impressive and extraordinary array of scientific talent, both up here and out there in the audience. But I think we all share a similarity. I think we all share a deep respect and an affection for John Bahcall and an appreciation for his exemplary work in astrophysics and his contribution to science. This certainly has been a fitting tribute and a memorial to his life and to his work. I have had the distinct privilege of knowing and working with John for 15 years. And it's interesting that Dr. Jim Gunn just told the story, because while you saw John's role in the Hubble telescope, he had a lesser known role in another very important telescope. I had just become a trustee of the Institute and got into numerous discussions or lengthy discussions with John about the value of what has come to be known as the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. And it was from those discussions that I was convinced to make the contribution that the Institute was to make to this project. And it was a kind of a warm story for me, because John came back to me and he said, Little Institute gave their money, and it shamed the trustees at the University of Chicago and Princeton to let the astrophysicists have their money. And that started the project, which I think is an extremely important project. It was, again, John's convincing. We all know he was convincing. When there was the first, I say threats, I hope there's no one from NSF here, the threats that we could lose very valuable NSF funding. And he was so convincing, I volunteered to undertake with my colleagues, trustees, colleagues, friends, to raise $10 million for the School of Natural Sciences. And it was just another way when John had an idea, he could figure out someone that would help him get it done. It was also both a great pleasure and honor for me to endow the astrophysics chair in support of John's work. For me, John has been the personification of excellence at the Institute. And like the object of his lifelong work, the sun, he's been a bright light in science and astrophysics. And his brilliance has been recognized formally, as you've seen today, by so many in the scientific community and in so many ways. And like the sun, he radiated incredible energy to both colleagues and to those very important people to us, especially the members here at the Institute in Astrophysics. His energy and guidance to those has stimulated, inspired, and really helped their careers, the careers of hundreds of the astrophysics members that have come through the Institute, and really made the work there so much worthwhile. And like the sun, he radiated warmth. Warmth that affected his members, his colleagues, his friends, and his family. Now it's our responsibility to continue John's legacy, John's momentum, his light, his energy, his warmth, and to transmit that to the future. I'm so pleased that we have Peter Goldreich in astrophysics here to continue his work while we also look for someone that can in some way again replace John at the Institute. So we have faculty in the interim while we seek additional faculty, but also we need to continue his other skill, that skill with members. And again, I think he's convincing me from out there somewhere, because I have talked with Peter Goddard, and we are going to raise the necessary endowment for 4 John Bahcall members. So I'll be calling on friends and colleagues, and Netta and the family have joined me in the initial investment. And John, I hope you're smiling.
Let me thank Rick for once more showing leadership in this area by initiating this this effort to, which I'm sure will be successful with his strong backing and with the backing of Netta and the family to endow these memberships. Let me also thank Professor Hsu for the fine gift of the bell, which we'll remember John every time we hear it. I'm grateful to everybody who's contributed to this program. Of course, the program's not over. We will be hearing from Netta and the other members of the family shortly. But I wanted to take this opportunity to thank everybody who'd come here and everybody who's participated. the many others who've been unable to attend who've sent tributes. Not everybody here, of course, has had the opportunity to speak. We're delighted to have with us Helen Quinn, President of the American Physical Society, of which, as you heard, John was president-elect until just before his death, and Harold Shapiro, formerly president of Princeton University, and Robert Goldston, the director of the Princeton Plasma Physics Lab, and Scott Tremaine, chairman of the astrophysics at Princeton University, who spoke this morning. And amongst so many others, we have people from all over the world. Art MacDonald from Canada, and Eli Waxman from Israel, both of whom spoke this morning. Rashid Sunyayev from Germany, Masataka Fukugita from Japan, and Evin van der Zerk and Tim de Zeeuw from Holland. If we were to read all the tributes that we've received, it would take many, many hours, if not days. So let me just quote from one as a representative, this one from James Binney in Oxford. He wrote to Netta to say, "I just wanted to say how sad I am to hear of John's passing. His deep love of science and truth were inspiring. His contributions to physics and astronomy were enormous, especially his courage and tenacious pursuit of the solar neutrino problem, which ultimately flowered into one of the most important advances in physics of the late 20th century. At first, the chairman of the Tuesday lunch was a rather fearsome figure. As I came to know him better, I realized that he was one of the kindest and most loyal and affectionate of men. I always much look forward to my spring visit to the Institute and the pleasure of seeing John and working in the vibrant atmosphere that he generated around him. And that was a significant part of what I look forward to." After the final part of this commemoration, I hope you will join us for reception in the dining hall.
Continue to remain friends forever. Shelby White and the late Leon Levy have been part of John and my family for a very long time, and we appreciate all the love and support and the friendship that we have had with you for so many years. The same goes for Phil and Taffy Griffiths, the former director here of the Institute. We regard you all as part of our family and are appreciating so much all your love and help and support throughout. And again, before I go to my remarks, I just want to thank all of you who came here. You're all friends, new friends of John, of mine, on the family, of the family. And we appreciate very much your coming here today and sharing this celebration. What I like to call it is really a celebration of John's life. He enjoyed his life. He has done a lot. He was happy with his life, and we are celebrating it today. Let me start by sharing with you a short family video that was prepared by our son, Dan, that covers different periods in John's life. I think we will show it, you'll see it in a moment. It's a 5-minute video clip. The young couple that you'll see, hopefully you recognize us, are John and I from 40 years ago. This video will be linked to John's website. Some of you have requested that, so the Institute would link it to his website. Dan also produced the longer family video that you've seen in the background while you're walking in, and it will be projected again during the reception later after the session is finished. So maybe we can have the family video. Do I need to turn it off here? Do I need to do anything? Do you have the music for that? This is a friend, Norm Lebowitz, playing tennis.